Hello and welcome to this video in which I take you through the main calculations associated with Ka, the so-called acid dissociation constant, and it's used to determine the pH of weak acid solutions. We'll be looking at solely monobasic acids, and at the bottom here you can see the equilibrium equation for the dissociation of a weak monobasic acid represented by Ha. The equilibrium expression Kc for the equilibrium is written thus: concentration of hydrogen ions times the concentration of A- ions over the concentration of the acid. Now, given that this is the equilibrium constant for the dissociation of a weak acid, first we change it from Kc to Ka, and then we can modify it in two ways. Firstly, since H plus and A- are produced in equimolar amounts, we can modify the top line to simply read the concentration of hydrogen ions squared. Secondly, being a weak acid, it dissociates only very slightly, so the concentration of the acid after dissociation is taken to be simply the concentration of the acid at the start. Let me now begin to build a flow diagram to show how the concentration of hydrogen ions in the acid solution is related first to the pH and then to the Ka value, the acid dissociation constant. So how do we get the pH of the acid from the hydrogen ion concentration? That's it. The pH is the negative log of the concentration of hydrogen ions. And if we have the pH, how would we get the concentration of hydrogen ions? That's it there at the bottom. We need to take the inverse log of the pH, or 10 to the power of minus the pH. And you see lots of examples of that kind of calculation through this video. Next, how is the concentration of hydrogen ions related to the acid dissociation constant Ka? Well, we have it, of course, there in purple at the bottom right. Ka is equal to the concentration of hydrogen ions squared over the concentration of the acid. Remember that H plus and A minus, in the case of a monobasic acid, are produced in equimolar amounts, and that because the acid dissociates only very slightly, the concentration of the acid at equilibrium is taken to be simply the concentration of the acid initially. Next, how then could we get the concentration of hydrogen ions from the Ka value? There it is at the top. It's the square root of Ka times the concentration of the acid. You get this formula, of course, by rearranging the equation in the bottom right, making the concentration of hydrogen ions the subject of the equation. When you have both Ka and the concentration of hydrogen ions, it's possible to obtain the concentration of the acid over there on the left. Once again, you'd rearrange that equation in the bottom right, making this time the concentration of acid the subject of the equation. And lastly, from the Ka, you can get what's called the pKa value. And there you see that to get the pKa from Ka, you take the negative log to the base 10 of Ka. How then would you get Ka from the pKa? This is like pH and reverse pH. To get the Ka from the pKa, the answer is 10 to the power of minus the pKa. And as you go through this video, you'll see lots of examples of that and other calculations in this particular flow diagram. So before we start looking at calculations that involve each and every one of these steps, let me summarize the key points. From the concentration of hydrogen ions, it's possible to get the pH. Equally, given the pH, it's possible to find the concentration of hydrogen ions. From the concentration of hydrogen ions, you can also get the acid dissociation constant Ka. When you know the Ka value, it's possible to obtain the so-called pKa value, and we'll see the significance of this shortly. And lastly, if you have both the Ka value and the concentration of hydrogen ions, you can obtain the concentration of the acid. We're now ready to look at a number of calculations that get you involved in each and every one of these different steps in the flow diagram. You might consider pausing at this point and copying down the flow diagram, particularly if you're fairly new to calculations of this kind. let's take a few moments to consider the benefit of taking the negative log to the base 10 of these small numbers. Consider the numbers in the left hand column. You can see there that they increase as you go up the column. Now, a very important note, the log to the base 10 of 10 to the power of any number, such as x, is simply x. I'll say that again, the log of 10 to the x is x. For example, the log of 10 to the power of 4 is simply 4. So let's see how that works and how it becomes a benefit dealing with these small numbers. In the left hand column we've got small numbers going from 0.1 down to 0.801. In standard form you can see those numbers represented in the middle. From at the top 1 by 10 to the minus 1 down to 1 by 10 to the minus 9. Now 1 by 10 to the minus 1 is simply 10 to the minus 1. So the log of 10 to the minus 1 is minus 1. But note that the right hand column is the negative log to the base 10. So the negative log of 10 to the minus 1 is minus minus 1, which turns out to be 1. The log of 10 to the minus 3 is minus 3. So the negative log of 10 to the minus 3 is minus minus 3, or 3. And at the very bottom we have the log of 10 to the minus 9. That's minus 9, so the negative log of 10 to the minus 9 is minus minus 9, or 9. You can see the benefit of taking the negative log of a small number. Look at that number at the bottom left, 0.801. It becomes simply 9. The problem, however, is that while you've got simpler numbers to deal with, the smaller number, the number with the smaller ka, turns out to be the number with the larger pka. You must bear that in mind. Another summary then, as the concentration of hydrogen ions falls, the Ka, or acid dissociation constant, falls as well. After all, the Ka is the concentration of hydrogen ions divided by the concentration of acid. So you can see that if the number in the top line, the concentration of hydrogen ions squared, is decreased, then the overall value of Ka is going to decrease as well. And just a moment ago we discovered that there is an inverse relationship between Ka and pKa, so as Ka falls, the pKa rises. That's the equation again that relates pKa to Ka. Okay, let's see if you can apply now what you've learnt to answer the following questions. Pause and have a go at this question on your own first of all. You see there the formula of phenol. And there's its dissociation equilibrium equation at the bottom. That H highlighted yellow there is the hydrogen that comes away to produce hydrogen ions. So phenol behaves as a monobasic acid. C6H5O- and H+ will be reduced in equimolar amounts. You see there we've been given the Ka as 1.3 by 10 to the minus 10 mole per cubic decimeter. That's an extremely small value, meaning that phenol behaves as an extremely weak acid. Now the first thing you'll need to do is to consider how we express the concentration of a chemical solution. We need to change grams per cubic decimeter here to moles per cubic decimeter. To do that, we'll have to work out the relative molecular mass of phenol, 6 carbons, 6 hydrogens, and 1 oxygen. Let's see what that adds up to give us. 612, 72, 616, and 16 for oxygen gives us a total of 94 for the relative molecular mass. Now, the question involves 38 grams in a cubic decimeter. Let's see what 38 grams is in moles. Well, if we divide the mass by the relative molecular mass, 94, that will give us the number of moles present in 38 grams. There it is, 0.404 moles per cubic decimeter, therefore. So in addition to the Ka value, 1.3 by 10 to the minus 10, we've now got the concentration of the acid phenol, 0.404. There's a reminder of the dissociation equation of the monobasic acid. And there's the expression for the Ka value of any monobasic acid, the concentration of hydrogen ion squared over the concentration of acid. Now, being a weak acid, it dissociates so little that the concentration of the acid after it has dissociated is taken simply to be the initial concentration, in this case 0.404. I shouldn't, of course, have put the 0.404 in square brackets there, sorry about that. Anyway, we have to consider now how to rearrange this equation to make the concentration of hydrogen ion squared the subject of the equation. What we need to do is to multiply both sides of the equation by 0.404, and there you see what we get, the concentration of hydrogen ion squared, 1.3 by 10 to the minus 10 times 0.404. So let's stick those figures into the calculator to see what that comes out to be, and that'll give us the concentration of hydrogen ion squared. And as you can see, in this case I've simply multiplied the 1.3 by the 0.404, so that gives me 5.252 by 10 to the minus 11. That's the concentration of hydrogen ion squared, so we need to take the square root of that value, 5.252 by 10 to the minus 11. So we've got that in the calculator now, simply hit the square root button, and that'll give us the concentration of hydrogen ions, 7.25 by 10 to the minus 6. And now that we have the concentration of hydrogen ions, we can find the pH. The pH is the negative log of the hydrogen ion concentration, so just taking the log of that number, and the negative log is minus minus 5.14, minus by minus is a plus, so the pH of the phenol is 5.14. Quite a high pH, a weak acid, which we would have predicted from the very small Ka value. Okay, that was the first of several questions. Are you ready for the next one? Once again, you should consider pausing it and having a go at the question on your own. Calculate the concentration of hydrogen ions in 0.0500 mole per cubic decimeter ethanoic acid, given that the pKa value is 4.76. Okay, so what have you got? You've got the concentration of the acid, 0.05 mole per cubic decimeter, and you've got the pKa value. So what's the first step? The first step will be to find the Ka. So how do we get Ka from the pKa? Ka is equal to 10 to the power of minus the Ka. Let's remind ourselves of the equilibrium equation for the dissociation of ethanoic acid. CH3COOH will dissociate to produce equimolar amounts of the ethanoate ion, also known as acetate ions, and hydrogen ions. And again, to get the Ka from the pKa, we take 10 to the power of minus the pKa, so it's 10 to the power of minus 4.76. On the calculator here, I have to hit the shift button and then the log button to get the 10 to the x button to come up. And so it's going to be 10 to the power of minus 4.76. And there's the answer, at least for the first part, 1.74 by 10 to the minus 5. That's the Ka value. Think about where you are in the flow diagram at this point. So we have both the Ka value and the concentration of the acid. So I write here the expression for the equilibrium constant or dissociation constant Ka, concentration of hydrogen ion squared over the concentration of the acid. The concentration of the acid is 0.05, and we have the Ka value 1.738 by 10 to the minus 5. Again, we need to rearrange this equation so that the concentration of hydrogen ion squared is the subject of the equation. Effectively, we have to multiply both sides by 0.05, Again, I shouldn't have put that in square brackets. And then we take the square root of that number. So there you have it. Let's stick those numbers into the calculator and work out the concentration of hydrogen ions. So 0.05 multiplied by 1.738 times, have to use the shift log key here to get the 10 to the x, times 10 to the power of minus 5. That comes out to be 8.69 by 10 to the power of minus 7. We need to take the square root of that then to get the concentration of the hydrogen ions. And that gives us, as you can see, (9.32 × 10⁻⁴). And of course that will be in mole per cubic decimeter. Okay, let's go on to a third equation. Again, I think you should pause and give this a go yourself. Once again, we're dealing with a weak monobasic acid, this time represented by the formula HZ. You've got to work out the dissociation constant Ka. You've been given the pH, and you've been given information that will allow you to work out the concentration of the weak acid. You've been given the number of moles and the volume of water. So this will be your first step, working out the concentration of the acid HZ from work that you will have done with titrations. You'll be familiar with the formula N equals CV, where N is the number of moles, C is the concentration, and V is the volume that is in cubic decimeters. You'll have to change your cubic centimeters to cubic decimeters by dividing by 1,000. So the number of moles is 0.2, the volume in cubic decimeters is 0.5. That gives us the concentration in the correct unit, mole per cubic decimeter. Turns out to be 0.4 mole per cubic decimeter. The question has asked us to calculate the value of Ka. So let's look at the flow chart here and map our way through this particular calculation. In addition to the concentration that we have, the question also gave us the pH of the acid, HZ, pH of 3.0. So what will we do with that pH? Well, the concentration of hydrogen ions can be obtained as 10 to the power of minus the pH. And when we have the concentration of hydrogen ions, together with the concentration of the acid, we can work out the value of the dissociation constant Ka. So if you haven't already done so, give it a go. See how you get on. So we obtain the concentration of hydrogen ions as 10 to the power of minus the pH. That's 10 to the power of minus 3. So let's do that. Need to use the shift log buttons to bring up 10 to the x. And x is minus 3, so let's put that into the calculator. You can see it's 1 by 10 to the minus 3, no surprise, or 0.001. But at least I have it in the calculator in the correct form. Now, with that together with the concentration of the acid will allow me to work out the value of Ka. There again is the expression for Ka of any monobasic acid, the concentration of hydrogen ions squared over the concentration of acid. 10 to the minus 3 squared over 0.4. 10 to the minus 3 squared is 10 to the minus 6. So what's Ka? 10 to the minus 6 divided by 0.4. Let's do that in the calculator. So 10 to the power of minus 6. And I need to divide that by 0.4, the concentration of the acid. And there's the answer. 2.5 by 10 to the minus 6. That gives me the value of the acid dissociation constant, Ka. And the units of Ka for a monobasic acid will always be mole per cubic decimeter. And here's your next question. Do pause and have a go. So this question is very similar to the previous question. You've been given the pH, 2.85, for a weak monobasic acid represented by the formula HX. And you've also got the concentration 0.10 mole per cubic decimeter. So again, you'll go from pH to concentration of hydrogen ions, and then from concentration of hydrogen ions to the Ka value. Reminder there of the equilibrium equation for the dissociation of that weak monobasic acid HX. To get the concentration of hydrogen ions, it's 10 to the power of minus the pH, so 10 to the power of minus 2.85. So again, I have to use the shift log button to get the 10 to the X feature to come up, and X has the value minus 2.85. And that comes out to be, as you see, 1.413 by 10 to the power of minus 3. That's the concentration of hydrogen ions, mole per cubic decimeter, of course. So we now have the concentration of hydrogen ions and the concentration of the acid. So we can work out the value of Ka from that expression. Put those numbers in, 1.413 by 10 to the minus 3 squared over 0.10. So I've put in 1.413 by 10 to the minus 3, and there I've squared it. And now I need to divide by 0.10. And the answer, Ka turns out to be 2.0 by 10 to the minus 5 mole per cubic decimeter. That's it. Okay, are you ready for another question? Here it is. Pause again and have a go at this. A little bit harder this time. Look at the information that you've been given. So you've got 1.9 grams of this weak acid, HX, dissolved in 500 cubic centimeters of water, or 0.5 cubic decimeters. From that you could work out the concentration, but to do so you'd need to change the 1.9 grams into moles. And of course you can't do that without knowing the relative molecular mass of the acid HX. The question's also provided the pH, 3.5, for that solution, and it's given the Ka value for HX. So what you can do is take that pH, 3.5, and take 10 to the power of minus the pH, 10 to the power of minus 3.5, and get the concentration of hydrogen ions. Then you can find the concentration of the acid, because you've got both the concentration of hydrogen ions and the Ka value. So let's look at these steps. From that pH, we'll get the concentration of hydrogen ions. From that, together with Ka, we'll get the concentration of the acid. From that, we can get the number of moles of acid present in the 500 cubic centimeters, which has 1.9 grams. And from that, we can get the relative molecular mass of the acid, HX. So again, you might like to pause and try these steps out yourself. Give it a go. So, step one, let's get the concentration of hydrogen ions from the pH. So the hydrogen ion concentration is 10 to the power of minus the pH, 10 to the power of minus 3.5. So again, I use the shift log buttons to get the 10 to the X feature to come up, the X being minus 3.5. And there you see it's 3.16 by 10 to the minus 4 mole per cubic decimeter. So that's the first step. Now we've got to get the concentration of the acid. And we'll do that by using both the concentration of hydrogen ions and the Ka value. So we need to rearrange that equation to make the concentration of acid the subject of the equation. Think about how you would do that. Well, you can use cross multiplication as shown here. you can cross multiply. 3.16 by 10 to the minus 4 squared times 1 is equal to the concentration of the acid times 2 by 10 to the minus 6. So working that out, this is what we have. And then to get the concentration of acid on its own, we divide both sides by 2 by 10 to the 6, and that's what we have there. So let's stick those figures into the calculator to work out the concentration of the acid. So that's 3.16 by 10 to the minus 4. Again, I have to use the shift log buttons to enter 10 to the minus 4. So that's 3.16 by 10 to the minus 4. I have to square that next. It gives me 9.9856 by 10 to the minus 8. And then I have to divide that by 2 by 10 to the 6. Again, rather awkward using the shift log button, unless you've got a 10 to the x button on your calculator. And so there's the answer. The concentration of the acid turns out to be 0.05 mole per cubic decimeter. Mole conversions are frequently involved in chemistry calculations, and this question is no exception. Take a look at the top line there in particular. You've got 500 cubic centimeters of solution containing this 1.9 grams of weak acid. Now we know the concentration of the acid, we've just worked it out. But this is not a cubic decimeter, it's half a cubic decimeter. So think about how we have to use that. We'll come to make that consideration in a moment, but you'll be aware that moles equals mass over relative molecular mass. And we'll be using this equation to find the relative molecular mass. So we rearrange it, swap moles with RMM, and RMM, the relative molecular mass of the acid, will be its mass divided by its moles. But let's work out how many moles of the acid we have. Now, we have half a cubic decimeter with 1.9 grams of acid in it. 0.05 mole per cubic decimeter means that you have 0.05 moles in a cubic decimeter. So in half a cubic decimeter, there will only be half as many moles. So the number of moles in this expression, the bottom left, is 0.025 moles. And the mass was given in the question as 1.9. So we divide the mass by the number of moles present in that half a cubic decimeter, and that gives us 76. That's it. That's the answer. The relative molecular mass of the acid HX is 76. Hope you got that. Perhaps time to take a short break and then come back to finish this video. Okay, so here's the next question. Do pause and have a go. You've been asked to work out which is the stronger acid based on a Ka value. At this stage, I'm sure you could do it very quickly by using the pKa value directly. The one with the smaller pKa is the stronger weak acid. But let's go ahead and get the Ka from the pKa values. The Ka, of course, is 10 to the power of minus the pKa, so that's 10 to the minus 3.6 versus 10 to the minus 4.1. Stick those into the calculator and get an answer. The first one is 2.5 by 10 to the minus 4. That's its Ka value. Remember, the one with the larger Ka dissociates more and is a stronger weak acid. Let's put in 10 to the power of minus 4.1 to get the Ka of the second weak acid. That turns out to be 7.9 by 10 to the minus 5. That's a smaller number. And so HX has got the bigger Ka, the smaller pKa. HX dissociates more. It is a stronger weak acid. Bigger Ka, smaller pKa makes the strongest of the weak acids. Okay, and on to the next question. Perhaps a little strange to encounter in this case the ammonium ion behaving as a weak acid in solution. So do pause and have a go at this. If you studied the Lorry-Bronsted acid-base theory, you'll have encountered this. It's commonly encountered there. The ammonium ion will dissociate to produce two species on the right, hydrogen ions plus ammonia molecules in solution. Again, it's important to note that the two species on the right are produced in equimolar amounts. So the ammonium ion is behaving as a typical monobasic acid. And the question here is relatively straightforward. You've been asked to get the pKa from the Ka. So what is the pKa? pKa is simply the negative log of the Ka, which in this case is the negative log of 5.62 by 10 to the minus 10. With such a very small Ka value, it's obviously an extremely weak acid. Stick those figures into the calculator. 5.62 by 10 to the minus 10. And then take the log of that. Turns out to be minus 9.25. So that's minus 9.25. Minus by minus is a plus. So it comes out to be 9.25. That's the pKa value. A very small Ka and a relatively large pKa, therefore. What it means in equilibrium terms is that the equilibrium lies very far to the left-hand side. Next question. We're nearly there. Pause and have a go. You see that you've been given the pH of butanoic acid, C3H7COOH. And you've been given its pKa value. So, what are the steps? Well, you'll start with the pKa. What can you get from that? Just one thing. From that you can get the Ka value, the acid dissociation constant for the butanoic acid. You've also been given the concentration of the butanoic acid. From the concentration of the acid and the Ka value, you can get the concentration of hydrogen ions, and from that you can get the pH. So pause and have a go if you haven't tried already. Follow those steps. So the first thing I'm going to do is turn the pKa into a Ka. Ka is 10 to the power of minus the pKa, in this case minus 4.82. Again, on my calculator I have to use the shift and log keys to bring up the 10 to the x function, x being minus 4.82, and that comes out to be 1.51 by 10 to the minus 5. So that's the Ka value for butanoic acid. There's the expression for Ka for a weak monobasic acid. We rearrange that expression to make the concentration of hydrogen ion squared the subject of the equation, and then we take the square root of that, as you see, to get the concentration of hydrogen ions. So let's stick those figures into the calculator. 1.51 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 5, and then I have to multiply that by 0.2. and take its square root, and there's the answer, 1.74 by 10 to the minus 3 mole per cubic decimeter. That gives us the concentration of hydrogen ions, and if we want the pH from that, we take the negative log. It comes out to be minus 2.76, or minus 2.8 minus minus 2.8, so the answer is 2.8. That's the pH of 0.2 molar, or 0.2 mole per cubic decimeter butanoic acid. And lastly, a very simple question to finish. pause and have a go at this. Arrange these weak acids in order of increasing acid strength. So you've been given their pKa values there on the right. Place them in order, starting with the weakest and finishing with the strongest. So what do? We use the pKa values. Butanoic acid has the largest pKa value and is therefore the weakest of the four acids shown. Here you see the structure of the anion formed from the dissociation of two chlorobutanoic acids. That chlorine group marked in green there is highly electronegative. It's said to be electron withdrawing. It'll pull electrons from that carbon it's attached to. That carbon in turn then will pull more on the electrons in the bond between it and the carbon of the carboxyl group. And that in turn will pull on that extra electron represented by the blue dash there that's on that oxygen. And that helps to stabilize that anion. What's making it unstable is the negative charge. The withdrawing of the electrons to some extent from that oxygen helps to stabilize it, makes the anion therefore more stable, and as a result that particular acid dissociates more, producing a higher concentration of hydrogen ions. You might like to look at this table showing a number of different weak acids, starting with the weakest ascorbic acid there with a pKa value of 11.8. Remember, the larger the pKa, the weaker the acid. That's what ascorbic acid looks like, otherwise known as vitamin C, of course. And that completes my look at the use of the acid dissociation constant in calculating the pH of weak acids, and the use of Ka and pKa to compare the strengths of different weak acids, like in the table that you're looking at here. Uric acid is in the middle of this table. That's what it looks like there. And at the bottom there you can see the strongest is oxalic acid. It's got the largest Ka, the smallest pKa value. Oxalic acid is found, I think, in rhubarb leaves, where it is a poisonous material. You will find a second related video which looks at the pH of buffer solutions. Such calculations also use Ka values.